Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
All right, we have the tools, we have talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right. Hello, everybody. How's it going? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. Thank you guys for being here. This is an Open Lines Friday. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti, and this is episode 195. Man, we are five away from 200. Wow. Thank you, guys. If you've seen all 200 at that point, wow. I wish I had some kind of prize to commemorate it. But you have my deepest thanks. If you've been here all 195 so far, you have my deepest thanks. Holy smokes. All right, so an open line show. I've got the link at the top of the chat. It should be there anyway. If it's not, I'm going to be putting the link here for you. If you do want to join tonight, it's via YouTube. So if you're on Twitter, because this simulcasts onto Twitter as well. If you're on Twitter, you got to come onto YouTube. Then you can click the link, and then you can join. Camera, audio, all that good stuff. Now, if you are going to join, or if you ever stream, I really recommend having a microphone, or at the very least, if you're not going to have a dedicated mic, make sure to have headphones. If you don't have headphones, and you don't have a dedicated mic, we could still do it, but you're not going to sound as good as you could possibly sound. Don't ask me why, it's technical mumble jumbo, all that stuff, but you know, just something to think about. But if you don't want to join, we can just talk, you can be in the chat, I could be here addressing your questions, comments, whatever it is you want to talk about. I do have a couple things I want to talk about tonight, just in case nobody does join, but we shall see. So yeah, so Open Lines Fridays, that's kind of how it goes. Every now and then I'm going to be doing a feedback forum show. Last Friday of every month, I had said this a couple days ago, we're going to be doing Open Mic Friday. So next Friday, the 26th, at 9:30, is the return of the Open Mic Show where people get to come on and promote for a few minutes. Since we're getting back in the swing of things, and it's going to be once a month, people will get 5 minutes at a time, courtesy of the Timey Tim timer. That's this little feller. He used to be around a lot more. He'll be coming back again. And then once he rings, your time is up. We got to wrap it up. On to the next person. That should be fun. I'm curious to see how many people will show up to talk about their projects or what they're working on or whatever else it is that they want to use with that 5 minutes or so of time. But again, that's next Friday, the 26th. Last Friday of every month. That's how we'll do it. All right, so before I get started with what I want to talk about tonight, first of all, let me put that up there. There we are. I'll say hello to you guys. Thank you for being here. We got Doc Mask in the chat. What's up, Doc? Derek Clay, how's it going, Dirk? Hope you're doing well. Thank you for being here. Christopher over on Twitter. What's up, Chris? Local boy. How's it going, Chris? Ravindra, what's up? Says, what's good? Right now, waiting for ink to dry. What you doing? What you doing? What you making? What Geeks Do Network says, hey, everyone, excited for the show. Thank you, What Geeks Do. Christopher, yeah. Yeah. So Chris is also in New Hampshire. And that's the reason for that. There you go. Shrek says, I'm here for the second day in a row. Well, thank you, Shrek. I appreciate that. You've been here for a lot more than that. Even though, you know, it might not have, you might have missed whatever it was 3 nights ago or something. But you've been here for a boatload of them. The No Prize. Yeah. The infamous Marvel Comics No Prize. I kind of have something like that for you. Only instead of a No Prize, I just have my thanks. Ravindra, I'll join a bit later, hopefully. Oh, yeah, that'd be great. Feel free to stop by. I'm going to be really doing my best to keep it to an hour tonight, only because this weekend is going to be a big weekend. We've got Alterna Comics art, book, comics, collectibles, auctions going on this weekend on the Alterna Comics channel. And those start at 8:30 Eastern tomorrow, Saturday, and then Sunday. It's an auction stream, but it's also going to be a closeout stream, too, for the Blood Realm campaign that Rob Geronimo is running. So I need to save my my sitting strength for those 2 nights. But yeah, I gotta keep it to about an hour tonight. So we'll be on until about my time anyway, 10:30 or so. Let's see. Adam Lawson. What's up, Adam Lawson? Good to see you. And good to see people commenting on Twitter. Charlie says, good show yesterday, Pete. Looking forward to getting a good look at Zen Bounty Wars. Hope all is well. Thank you, Charlie. Appreciate that. Golden Tree TV is here. That's Madison. Madison Hawthorne was on the other night. That was a great show, too. How's it going, Madison? Ravindra says, I'll be there. Episode 200, you'll be there? I hope so. Arthur Elmet, what's up, Arthur? Hope you're doing well. Thank you for showing up tonight and being here in the chat. I appreciate seeing you. Derek says, doing well, Peter. I'm glad to hear that, man. If you want to stop in, anybody. If you guys want to stop in, have a little chat, we can do that tonight. Cole King, how's it going, Cole? Hope you're doing well. Ravindra says, making a webcomic page for part 3 of chapter 1. Ah, so you're going about it traditionally and then scanning it in and all that? You're not going the digital route 100%? A lot of people do that. I don't draw digitally. I letter digitally because there's no way I'm going to be able to do that traditionally. Writing it out. Just I don't have that consistency in my writing. But I think the most I've done art-wise digitally has been inking and whatnot. Everything else is traditional. So if you feel that way too, I get it. Chris Six Strings, what's up, Pete? What's up, chat? There you go. Thank you for being here, Chris Six Strings. All right. Yeah. See, you get it. Yeah, same here, lettering on the pewter. Traditional lettering, hand lettering. It's a lost art, you know, and I'm contributing to that, unfortunately. But I really respect and appreciate the hand lettering of days gone by. Oh, man. And then it's especially not just the lettering of the dialogue or anything like that, but the mastheads and the logos and all that. Oh, that's a whole amazing set of skills that I really, I'm in awe of that as well. And, you know, when you get those original art pages, you see them all with everything that's on there, and that's intense. You know, really cool. Doc says, what program do you use for lettering, Pete? So, right now, I pretty much just use Photoshop. A lot of people don't want you to use Photoshop, or don't want to use Photoshop, or don't like to use Photoshop for lettering. What I'm doing with it, I don't mind going that route. And the reason that I can do that with King Cryptid is because I'm not exactly utilizing some of the features that would be easier to use through Illustrator, or that you can only really find through Illustrator. I know some people use, what is it, like Manga Studio or something or other. I don't know what else people use for their lettering at this point. But I'm using Photoshop, and it's been pretty easy for me to do what I gotta do with it. And then it's easy to create the shape, turn it from a raster into a vector and all that other stuff. The technical stuff. Like I said, there's a lot of technical mumbo jumbo when it comes to all of this. But the lettering program that I use is Photoshop. And I always, you know, you go in there and you can use whatever program you use of your choice. There's so many of them out there now, and they all do relatively the same sort of thing. Some of them are a little better than others, with depending on what you want to do. But I really like the ability within all these programs that you can adjust the kerning and the letting. And that's, letting's the space between the lines, the kerning's the space between the letters. That's really important. You know, as I've learned more over the years about lettering as well, that's been really helpful to understand that you want to have this equidistance, and that some things happen with lettering, digitally especially, where you got to bring something in a little bit. You know, you got to make sure you adjust that. And then even when it comes to some people, I've seen letter, and they'll do a strange thing, which is they want it to follow the context and shape and outline of the balloon. And that's not entirely strange, but sometimes they'll do it so much so that they just let the program take over, and you'll be stuck with all of these words that are constantly hyphenated. And that's something you really want to avoid as much as you can. It's going to happen every now and then, but especially when someone's ending a sentence on like a 3 or 4 or 5 syllable word, or something that's, you know, huge, 15 characters or something like that, so you know that thing's gonna get hyphenated, find a way to end that sentence differently. You can still put that word in there maybe, but find a way to end that sentence differently. That's a big part of the lettering aspect of comics, where you really do need to have editing in mind. That when you see that lettering and you see your writing get placed, or you put the writing in the dialogue or the caption or whatever it may be, that you are keeping in mind the way that that's going to fit in those balloons, box, whatever it may be, is really important. So visually, you have to understand, you got to make sure it looks okay. And that's something I find that, you know, if you're the writer and the letterer, which is what I do, it's a lot easier to do that. If you're the writer and then you pass off your stuff to the letterer and you never really kind of revisit it, and you just give it to them and you never look again at the lettering or tell the letterer what to bold, italicize, you know, emphasize, whatever it may be, that could be a tricky situation. But I really like to letter my own writing. I don't like handing it off. I don't think I've ever done that. I don't think I've ever handed off my own writing, even in short stories, to a letterer. So I have dealt with a lot of people who do that, though. And then I'll read the comic afterwards and wonder, well, why didn't they communicate to the letterer about some of these things? You know, but on most of these books, I'm not the editor, unfortunately, and that's me overstepping my bounds a lot of the time. If it's like a red flag and it's a really big, obvious issue, then I bring it up. But if it's me just kind of stylistically nitpicking, then I refrain from that because that's not necessarily my place. I know that's a bigger answer than what you maybe wanted there, Doc. But there you have it. Doc says, hand coloring too. Cool to look at those old colorist art. Yeah, I mean, the way they would do color separations and everything too, that's... Whew. That's a... You can kind of mimic it nowadays. Especially there's some digital brushes with coloring that you can really do a pretty good job of mimicking old school coloring. But the way that it was done back then compared to the way it's done now, I don't even know how to properly explain it. It was so much more complicated than it is now. It's interesting. Yeah, some of you guys using Clip Studio to edit, or to letter, I should say. Yeah, a lot of people use a lot of stuff. Revenger's using Photoshop. You know, most people use Illustrator, they'll say that, but I can do everything I need to do without having to import it, or I should say export it from Illustrator to Photoshop. I can do everything I need to do within Photoshop. Doc says, I'm leaning toward Clip Studio, not too expensive. Yeah, I'm not doing the Photoshop pay monthly thing. I've never done that. The last version of Photoshop I have is the last one you could own. And that's it. Every time I always, you know, check it out, I get the idea to download the trial and see did anything change. And I'm always like, all the changes on here I wouldn't even really use. You know, it's a lot of stuff that has to do more with if you're creating, drawing digitally and doing a hell of a lot more than I need it for. I forget which version of Photoshop it is exactly. Is the one that I technically would have, and that I the one that you don't need to pay for monthly on a subscription model. But let me see if I can find that out for a second. What that is? I've had it for so long I can't even remember the exact edition. I want to say like CS6 or something like that. I don't know. That's gonna take too long for me to find that. CS6, whatever. Whatever it is that the last version is that you didn't need to do a subscription for. Ravindra says, yeah, avoid words breaking in a bubble. Yeah, or break off the dialogue into different panels. Yeah, see, yeah, like that, right? You know? And usually the hyphen would be... So it would be differ and then hyphen and then ently. Is how that would go, but you know, I understand your point, Metatron. Absolutely. Doc says, I have a crowdfunded comic that I backed a couple of years ago. Art is great, lettering is so bad, I get a headache when I try to read it. I see that from time to time, and I always wonder, should I say something to the creator? Like, I'll see that shared every now and then, and I'm like, man, the art is looking great, but the lettering, you know. Have you thought about this or that or the other thing that's going on there with... It's a rough thing. I have to hold back. I don't want someone to get offended by that. But at the same time, you know, a part of me is like, oh, maybe I should say something. But I usually don't. Unless I know the person that I could send them a DM and I know them personally enough and I've had conversations where I feel I could not come across like I'm trying to be a jackass. And that they know me enough that I'm not trying to do that. But I've seen things too that are like that, Doc. It's frustrating. It really is. Derek says, I tried lettering Ballad of the Celestials. It was okay, but I was not up to the level we wanted. Well, it's good for you to know. You know, it's good for you to know and acknowledge that. That's important. To understand where you're at and being able to be honest with yourself about that. That's important. I mean, if anything, that's how you're going to learn and grow as a letterer if you wish to continue to pursue that. You know, but when you look at it and you're completely satisfied with it, thinking, nah, nothing else I got to do here. This is perfect. That's when it's bad. You know, that's when no one's going to be able to tell you at any point in time that you have to brush up on some of these things, because you are so set in feeling like you don't have to learn anymore. That you're always going to feel like, yeah, no, they must be saying it because they're jealous, or they're trying to tear me down, or you know, you'll come up with all these kinds of excuses. But it's good that you're honest with yourself. That's a big step. Doc says, no, that is great. I always appreciate you explaining things. Well, no problem. I always feel like I'm rambling about it sometimes. I bet it is. Probably part ramble, part solid explanation. That's okay. Awesome one, and thank you for being here. Metatron's Cube says, I have a copy of 5.5 Photoshop still. Shrek says, I still use Office 2007. Man, I haven't even used... That went to subscription model too, right? Didn't all those Microsoft whatchamacallits do that? I think I use like Libre or LibreOffice or whatever the heck that is. It's like an open source thing that looks and behaves and does exactly the same kind of thing that Microsoft programs do. Golden Tree TV says, I miss those days where you could own the software. Yeah. It seems like a lot of them do that subscription model thing nowadays. And Shrek goes, I own it. Yep. Metatron, it's something like that. I want to say CS6. Whatever is literally the last Photoshop that was not a subscription model, that's the one I have. Can't stand that subscription model stuff for the software. Horrendous. Buddha Bear, how's it going, Buddha Bear? What's up? Thank you for being here tonight. And thank you for the heads up earlier about the Alterna art auctions not being set to the correct days. Good grief. I did that once before. And it appears I did it again today. So now they are set to the correct days. Tomorrow and Sunday, starting at 8:30 Eastern. Dyrus. Or Dyrus. I'm going to call you Dyrus. Unless you want to correct that. And please feel free. Says, honest feedback is good. Absolutely. MD Houghton says, I welcome everyone to critique my art. Please, I normally have to pay for that sort of service. Well, there you go. MD, if I see something ever that I'm like, ooh, I think I should say something, then I shall. I always view it as like, hey, got your back. You know, before you get this thing published, before you get it printed, it's better to know. Like, I've had people that have read... either a preview page I've posted or maybe read the digital, and they were like, oh, before you get it printed, is there a way, you know, let them know that there's a typo here. And sometimes, you know, it's a little too late, and that's our fault, obviously. But sometimes it's been great, and people that have read the digital books or whatever it is before they get sent to the printer, they manage to help us out. So that's appreciated. I always like that. Derek says, please say something to me if you see something not up to par. I was already the illustrator and inker and project manager. I couldn't take on a new skill at that time. I hear you, man. Well, you know, that's a whole other thing. Devil Flyer. What's up, Devil Flyer? Hope you're doing well. Let's see. We also got... you're using that too, man, Ravindra? It's pretty good. It's good, you know? Nice open source, free, and works great. Buddha Bear says, rule one in a truck driver's handbook. If you know everything there is to know about driving, retire. Oh, interesting. All right, let's see. We got somebody back here waiting in the wings. And let's see who that is. We got Momentum Rex. What's up? How's it going?
Hey, it's good to see you, Peter. It's been good about to see a year. You. Man, I went to my local comic book shop and I scored some Alterna books.
Oh, you must have been getting books from back in 2019 or something. What did you get?
The Eden series.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah.
Like the whole thing, you know, and then there was another title. But yeah, I always like to pick up, you know, and picked up a Pit number one with Del Keon, anybody, and a couple Florida Men, Mike Barron, you know, number one issues with different covers. So it's exciting to get some of the stuff within the community, you know, at your local comic book shop.
Yeah, very nice. Well, what is your local comic shop anyway? Do you want to give the name? Do you want to disclose that?
I can't. I rarely go there. I only have like one book on my pull list, and that's Spawn. But now there was one called Nomads, and before they went out of business, they were ordering Alterna books, and they were cited in the back of Alterna books, you know, years ago. I said, man, you ought to try out Alterna. Next thing I knew, they had a whole spinner rack full of Alterna stuff. And that was the first Alterna stuff I bought.
Wow.
I mean, I'd already picked up, you know, through crowdfunding and issue here or there. But yeah, it was nice to get, you know, Mighty Mascots for the first time and some of those 80 pagers.
I wish a lot of those shops
put out some of the best product out there. You know,
I wish a lot of those shops would continue to order it from us direct. They could actually get a bigger discount and better service from doing so. But so many of them chose not to.
The pandemic took a hit on some of those stores, and they're still, I mean, statistically speaking, most of the stores stay in business for about a couple of years. And a lot of that's just poor business management, you know. But
yeah.
The, you know, at one time we had three here. But now one's closed down and been closed, and they're still here. Two that's, I think they're going to stay in business. Like one's been in business for a while.
Good.
And this other one's seems pretty strong. So, and I do see, I even got a War Party there. I was like, whoa,
Wow.
And, then at the other one, I picked up, Mighty Titan, you know, the little mouse, that looks like Batman. Have you seen that?
No, I'm not familiar with that one. Who puts that out?
Okay. I'm trying to think of the guy's name that does that. Somebody help me out in the chat. I bet Dr.
Mighty Titan?
Mighty Titan, yeah. I think it's over on Find My Comic now, but it's been on Indiegogo. Gary, what's his name? Martin, maybe? He's great. He's a good artist.
Oh,
I think you'd really like his stuff, you know.
Nice. So, what's on your mind tonight, Rex?
Oh, you know what? I just saw, I was on X and saw you were like, hey, join the show. And it's like, man, I hadn't talked to Pete in forever. And, you know, the first beanie I ever got on a crowdfunder was an Alterna beanie, although mine's red. That might have been the first beanie you ever came out with.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. The first one we came out with was the red with the white logo, and we've had
it's back
four
there somewhere.
Or five since. Yep. I'm waiting on my King Cryptid ones. Those should get here in like 2 weeks or something.
Yeah,
that'd
man, you're
nice.
Knocking it out of the park. We got to set something up where you can kind of come on. Yeah, Gary Shipman. That's his name. Yeah.
Okay, that's his name. Gary Shipman does Titan.
That does Mighty Titan.
Mighty Titan. Okay.
I actually backed him and was very satisfied. 1, 2, and 3. I did a catch up
nice.
Here, then third, and he's went on since then. But all of them consigned really nice and, you know, shipped tonight. But yeah, you're killing it, man, with this comic book radio. You've had some great guests on.
Oh, thank you, man. I appreciate it. Yeah, it's been crazy. 195 episodes. I can't believe it. Every time I mention the episode number.
Yeah.
And we're getting closer to 200. That's nuts. I can't believe it, but it's been a blast.
I know you're busy, but you know, I hope you'll consider coming back on my channel and giving us, you know, the spiel about King Cryptid. Cause I remember King Cryptid 1, 2, and 3 were not even out yet. I don't think, when we last had you on, so it's been a while. We like
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, if you throw some days and times at me for May, okay, I could probably get something going. Usually I book everything like a month in advance between this show and any kind of show I'm going to be on. It's really rare when I manage to just get someone in there at the last second, and that's usually because someone else dropped out. Yeah. So, send some dates and times to me about that.
Recently, that way somebody had dropped out, and I'd ask him, you know, and he said, sure, and got on there for like about 15 minutes, you know. Talk about good. Devil Flyer, because I'm over on Fun My Comic right now, and we had Andy Smith and Dennis Turner on today talking about Core Draft. They just launched that. Hawk Blaylock launched his today, sort of noir book, Damn Dirty Thing.
Is that the name of the title?
Damn Dirty Thing. Yeah.
Damn Dirty Thing.
Yeah, he did a. It's part of the Pariah Blood and Mud series.
Okay.
But he's got almost like a 90-page novella that he's written, and they get 4,000 as a stretch go. They're about at 1,000 now the first day. they're going to do an audiobook. I'd like to see more audiobooks, frankly.
Of you mean like audio comics?
Yeah, audio comics. Yeah. Well, oh, yeah, that'd be great. Novel, you know, a novella. But yeah, it's about 90 pages that would be acted out. Hey, Jason.
Yeah. I think some comics you could probably adapt. Like Rob Geronimo did adaptations of a couple of his issues to audio. Mm-hmm. And it works out well with the way that he writes his story. But there's some comics that I don't think you could adapt them straight. You'd have to kind of retool them a bit to adapt them to make an audio book. But
like if
I think that'd be great.
Has his main thrust world that he's done for a dozen issues, right? You could always do, okay, here's a side faction, you know, of that world. Still part of that same world, but something different.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, just adapted for audio.
Definitely.
I'd like to see more audio. I think more people would.
Oh, yeah, it's great to just have on in the background and, you know, you're working, you're getting other things done. I love audiobooks for that reason, too. I can't stand, though, when people say that it's reading. No, it's listening.
Yeah.
Listening.
And it's
okay to say it's listening.
You know, I like audio because I read more books that way. I mean, I drive at night, you know, when it's mosquito season, because that's what I do. And if you don't listen intently, you know, sometimes I'll drift off with my mind. I can always back it up and pick it up where I left off. But I used to do a lot of audio books like that. But you have to kind of focus on what's being said.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Sure, it's almost like a silent movie, you know, with no dialogue. You tend to sometimes drift off with your mind and you got to refocus. But
true.
There was more folk. And I see some of these campaigns are doing like vinyl items. You mentioned Geronimo. He's got like a vinyl record, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah. I can't wait to get that.
Yeah, that's killer. Yeah.
He's only got a couple of those left, too. He's almost sold out. I think the last time I checked with him, he has like five left.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I like it when people do novel things like that. You know, I mean, if we're going to be niche, we might as well be, you know, I hear that comics are niche. That almost gets under my skin, Peter, because I'm such a diehard collector, you know.
Yeah, it's like how long do they have to be around and in every aspect of everything to no longer be considered that?
Now, are they healthy and should they, you know, absolutely, you know, Marvel and DC should be knocking it out of the park, Peter.
Oh, yeah, well, there's been many opportunities.
They got 90 years behind them, you know, whatever. I mean, they should be doing some incredible stuff. And I agree with Cecil and others that have talked about this, is that Marvel really should have capitalized, but this is old news. Should have capitalized on the movies, because people were going to the comic book shops and getting something else. They weren't getting the Tony Stark they were seeing on the movies. They were getting Ironheart or something else. You know, it didn't match up with the movies, and it really should have if they wanted to really capitalize and make bank on that stuff. You know,
well, something really that's weird about the entire comic industry in general is that it isn't niche, but they sure want it to be. And it's strange that you can't just go, and you used to be able to, right? Go to any store and looking good. And it used to be able to go to any store and find comics. Yeah. Not all of them, but you'd find some of them. Mm-hmm. You know, and for some reason it became like, you know, we don't put comics into the stores. And I've heard all the excuses where it's about, oh, well, the stores don't want to stock a product that is that price and this and that. Give me a break. It's not that. These stores carry all kinds of products that are taking up more room than comics and move less of that product and also are priced less than that product. So it's not about that. It's about there's been a lot of different distribution interruptions within comics, and the way that it's been handled has pretty much been handled where whoever is utilizing those systems does not want to play ball with how that store runs their businesses. So they don't want to have that system in place where you have to say, okay, here's what we're going to send to you. Here's what we're offering up. Let's say that a publisher offers up, I don't know, depending on the size, maybe their top five titles. Maybe they're top 10, you know, but do they have that stability within the lineup to say these are consistently, this is what our top five, our top 10 characters or titles are, or this is a book that should be in the stores because a movie's coming up and this is a re-release to get people kind of into it or anything like that. They don't do anything like that. Instead, the whole system is kind of dependent upon how the distributor wants to handle it. And most distributors are not going to handle it that way.
I'm no expert on this, but look at all the pre-sale that they did, and you know, follow me over here, you know, on the Blair Witch movie. The selling on the Blair Witch movie was such that people just went to see it in droves. Now, I wasn't one of those because it's not kind of my thing, but it was a success because everybody was kind of intrigued by the pre-sale. We don't kind of package things like that. And I've got something occurred to me while you were talking, and I was thinking about all the great stuff you've been producing of late on your campaigns. I know you try and get the books out to the local comic book shops, but have you considered an after the campaign sort of leftover tchotchkes bundle to send to stores that they might want to order, or is that viable
idea? Oh man, they tend to want those even less.
Really?
Yeah.
That's sad.
Yeah. If anything, I find that sometimes it feels like, and this is from my own experience, some people can have a different experience and some people I'm sure do. But in my own experience, sometimes it feels like the most difficult store to sell a comic book to get it in that store is a comic shop. And it's strange to say that, but the way that the market's been and the way that it's so overcrowded and there's not a lot of shops to support the weight of the industry, it's a strange thing. And you know, over the years I've shifted priorities with that, because for 12 or so years, that was a priority, was to sell to the comic shops and to the retailers and to try to let the readers know, go to your local comic shop, pick them up. And then eventually it became a frustrating endeavor for me and for the readers and also for the creators that had their books, because they would do that. But then, you know, 80-85% of stores wouldn't ever stock the book, much less even get it sometimes for customers on a pull list. I couldn't believe that when I had customers telling me that they can't even get the book on a pull list. I was like, that doesn't make any sense. They're like, they just didn't want to put it on there.
And you used to go through Diamond, but no more.
Yeah. Right? We haven't been with Diamond in 4 years. 4 years and 4 days. Because April 15th, 2020 was when we left.
I think you were kind of going against, initially, you were going against the crowd. You were doing like trade paperbacks at first, right?
Yeah. When we got into distribution, we were just going straight to graphic novels and trades. And that worked best for the creators involved because they all had day jobs. They couldn't keep up with doing like a monthly or a quarterly or anything kind of single issue book. And I didn't want to, at that point in time, being a 2 year, 1.5 year old publisher or so, I didn't feel comfortable saying, you know, get me 2 issues done in advance and then we'll get the lineup going. So it was more like, you know, whatever, what works best for you, I want to go that route. And every one of them wanted to go the graphic novel and trade route instead and put out like one, maybe two trades a year, depending on the kind of story or the kind of creator that they were.
Right.
And that worked out. And then we did that for about 10 years. And then 2017 came, and that was when we made a go of it with doing the newsprint single issues. And then that had a whole host of things that brought upon doing it that way. So there's always something, you know, whenever you try any endeavor and any avenue of sale or whatever it might be, or a new product line or a new book, whatever it is, there's always going to be something. But it was weird to see at that point a lot of the talk that people were disappointed in coming from retail was the price point. They didn't like the $1.50 price point. It was too cheap. And I got messages from a lot of retailers that like this was going to ruin the industry and blah, blah, blah. And this, and I don't know if they thought that the rest of the publishers would follow suit and bring the product level down. And I understood where they were coming from, because they would think, okay, if everyone's books were $1.50, you know, we can't sell enough books to support paying the rent or making a livelihood or whatever it might be. But that wasn't going to happen. The rest of the industry wasn't going to come down and bring their prices down, especially the large majority of the industry. It was corporate run. There's no way on earth Marvel and DC corporate owners are going to entertain the prospect of cutting a book by 60 to 70% of the cover price.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they'll offer some here and there, you know, like they did, lines and whatnot, but that wasn't going to happen. So there was all kinds of different weird things thrown at me for why they didn't want to carry the books in the store. And then some of the other excuses were, oh, well, you know, no one's coming in here to order alternative books. And, you know, so we're not going to stock the book. And I said, every one of our books are different. Every title's different. So especially the newsprint lineup, we haven't done newsprint single issues ever before. We've been around since 2006. At that point, it was 2017. But we've had a New York Times bestseller. We've had books get national press coverage. We had a book adapted to film. And I'm like, did you carry any of those books in your store? Those are very popular.
Was it The Chair?
It was, it was FUBAR Volume 2, Empire of the Rising Dead. And that was in 2012 that made the bestsellers list. You know, and even then,
The Chair came later, didn't it?
No, The Chair was really early on. And so The Chair never made the New York Times bestsellers list, because it was more of like to make the bestsellers list is like you got to have an influx of sales immediately. Mm-hmm. Like you got to have like that one big, really good week.
Yeah.
And The Chair was more of like a slow, steady stream.
And do they do pre-order? Sales. They do pre-orders too, right? On that? Some of the books do? They do pre-orders?
Diamond, everything is a pre-order.
Yeah.
But yeah, so for all that stuff, it never correlated to success in the comic shops, even if we had success in the book distribution part of the industry. So the comic shops wanted to order what they wanted to order, and most of the time it definitely wasn't anything that we were making, that's for sure. So when we did the newsprint single issues, it was again a frustrating thing, because even the stores that would order, they'd have success with them and would sometimes send me some really nice emails. Oh, we ordered 40 of this and it sold out, you know, day one. You know, like, we're going to get 15 in of issue two. And I'm thinking, like, why would you get 15 in of issue two if you just sold out of 40 on day one? You know, like, sounds like you need more of issue one.
Yeah.
And you should order at least 40 of issue two. Otherwise, you're going to have minimally 30 customers or so that are probably going to come back looking for issue two of that three-issue miniseries and being disappointed that they can't find that book. You know, and then you got to reorder it through Diamond. You get a lesser cut when you reorder through Diamond, because Diamond takes a bigger cut on reorders. And then it takes even longer to get the book. So now it's going to take like a month for you maybe to get the book if Diamond sends me the reorders, which they didn't send for about 16,000 books. It was a whole mess. I wouldn't go back to distribution.
Didn't they have free samples to certain?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We sent out a lot of free samples. We sent out also kind of like a thank you packages. Like we did something for a while where we had the readers write into us about their local comic shop and send us a nice letter, you know, what did they appreciate and like about their local comic shop. And so they would email that into us, and then I think we did like maybe 50 50 or 60 care packages that were like that. And we sent a stack of like 10 preview books and then like a couple stickers and a tote bag and this and that, whatever, along with the letter and note that was from that customer of theirs. And only two shops out of the 60 some odd shops that we sent those out to had even mentioned to thank you, to send a thank you back to us, had even sent an email or anything back to us saying, hey, we got this thing in and this was really nice.
Yeah.
So even on that level, I was like, man, this is weird.
The reason I ask is I was over in a comic shop where a friend of mine lives and over in Jackson, Tennessee, and they had some of your books that they didn't carry alternate lines. Of course, I played it up when I bought those. I didn't have those. And then there's some that I bought doubles of, you know, because I know, you know, like I think Dr. Mass mentioned Brog and, you know, some of it came out on a Wednesday. I knew you were going to do the King Cryptid and the thing you were leading up with these characters, these covers that you were putting on the character, you know, the starting with issue 7, I think, you know, and I thought I'm going to buy extras of that. Just like that one that you sold out recently. I've got some of those. I don't know if I've got ads in those or what, but I've got extra copies. I mean, but they had like your books in the dollar bin. I couldn't snap them up quick enough. I was like, Pete must have sent them a care package or something. He's like, I said, where'd you get these?
I love when I go into a store and find old Alterna books in the dollar bin, because I know I can turn those around because they're far worth more than a dollar.
Yeah, especially if they've got the barcode, right?
If they manage to get a newsstand edition into the comic shop store, which can happen sometimes if a customer came in and sold books or whatever it is, or if they ordered directly from us, sometimes we did that.
Run, right?
But yeah, if you go on eBay and you find newsstand copies, because the newsstand copies, if they didn't sell, they got rid of them. So those got kind of eliminated through circulation.
Super rare.
But yeah, so those are a rarity. And we did that up until late 2019.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Up to two. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm always looking for the rare stuff, man. You said, it come out on Wednesday, number two, never going to be reprinted again. I went on eBay.
It came out on Wednesdays won't be reprinted again. Number one was reprinted. That's the only issue that ever got reprinted. And that was because there was all kinds of different circumstances that made us push towards a reprint. Not to mention, it immediately sold out. We sold our complete amount of it very quickly.
Do you put second printing on there? Or how do you designate
So the logo will look different. So on a first printing, it's any color other than gold, silver, or bronze. It's usually red, sometimes it's blue or green or black, but it's any color other than gold, silver, or bronze. If it's a gold printing, it's a second. If it's a silver printing, it's a third. And if it's a bronze, and the Alterna logo is a fourth printing. So if you find like Blood Realm number one with the red logo, that's a first printing. It came out on a Wednesday number one with the red logo, that's a first printing. And those are pretty rare, and I've seen those go for far more than I thought they would go for on eBay and other places like that. So if anyone comes across and you're digging through and your local comic shop has a bunch of old Alterna in the dollar bin or whatever it might be, you know, snag them up, because chances are that they're worth far more than that dollar.
Yeah, Peter, I mean, you know, this crowdfunding thing, it's like, you know, Ethan at one time was talking about Rec Planet being a run of like 17,000. He might have wound up printing 20,000. I don't know what the print run wound up being, but even at 20,000, I mean, back in the day, 60,000 and you got canceled, you know. All this crowdfunding stuff is rare and hard to find.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And to talk about your point about the 60,000 printed and whatnot that would get canceled too, I mean, now you can have a book that sells 60,000 and that's considered a pretty great selling book. And the biggest reason for that is because they lost the distillation of their line. So before, it used to be only a couple of books that were of that character. And maybe 20, 25, 30 books at that point in time were being consistently put out. Now it's a whole different metric. So it's all over the place. They're spreading the readers out across everywhere. And so they can't have those numbers that are as concentrated as they used to be. If they went back to, like, let's say there was 1 to 3 Batman books. Now you're talking about a lot of sales for those 1 to 3 Batman books. You're going to see that those numbers probably go 200, 250,000 because of the fact that you are now concentrating readership into those books. But if you make 10 or 12 or 15 or 20 Batman type books, you're spreading all that out. Not to mention you're also forcing the hand of the retailer to go, well, I only have enough shelf space, so I can only stock so much. Yeah. You know, you got to make sure you're, if you're a smart retailer, you got to make sure you're getting stuff that's going to move. You don't want to sit on too many. Maybe you only order enough so that you have, you know, 2 to 5 copies left over based on what you think you can sell.
You know, it's an ordering nightmare, and it always has been since the early days, like when I dealt with Capital, when Diamond wasn't even around. And basically, Capital just morphed into Diamond, although I know it was different. It's, you know, like, oh, I didn't get everything I ordered. Well, if you're small fry, you might not get those books. And you know, you got readership that said, oh, I didn't get a copy. Okay, we'll try and get you one. And that's all you can really say is I'll try and get you one, because often they didn't, you know, sometimes they would send, you know, if you were shorted or something, they'd send some. If it's a hot book, though, sorry, we're sold out. And your readership winds up not getting it. You know, it's always been a headache for you know, comic book owners.
Yeah, you know, and like I said before, that's the part of it that's such a shame, that they haven't figured out a way to provide some kind of consistency and stability among the bigger retail stores to get their top 5, their top 10 titles, whatever that might be, even if it's just character based, and get those into those stores, because that's where more people are going to see them and find them. And even if they become a loss leader to put those books in those stores, at least they're getting out there and you see that comics exist. I can't tell you how many signings I've done, and sometimes even conventions where people come up and they're shocked that there's still new comics. When it's at a convention, it's even crazier.
Yeah.
But anytime I ever did a Barnes & Noble or a bookstore signing, people would open up the book and be shocked that they go, oh, this is a comic book. I'm like, yeah, they call them graphic novels when they're like that, but yeah, it's a comic book. And they're like, they still make new comic books? You know, every time I did one of those, there'd be multiple people saying that comment, and they go, I never see them anywhere. I didn't know they still made new ones. I said, yeah, most of them are just at local comic shops now. So if you don't have a local comic shop in your area, chances are you don't know that new comics are being made.
Yeah, for whatever reasons, when you couldn't go into a drugstore, a grocery store or pharmacy or somewhere, and just stumble onto greatness, you know, other realms of reality and different planets and barbarians and superheroes, when you couldn't just stumble into that and go, wow, you know, kids went on to other things, you know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I mean, it killed the market. I mean, we're still really...
Well, I mean, it shouldn't have killed the market, but they definitely didn't play it to make it that it would have benefited from it. If anything, we see comic stuff everywhere now. We see the characters everywhere. Like you were talking about, they're in these movies, and they've been in movies for a while. And then now even on that level, they seem like they're kind of repeating a lot of the same mistakes that the comic industry made over the years, and they're going to get crushed under their own weight of their continuity. Instead of creating something that feels more episodic and something that has more of like a guest star factor of bringing in characters here and there, but you could still enjoy something on its own. Too much of it is becoming dependent upon what's happening down the street instead of what's happening inside the house. And that's the thing that's kind of frustrating for a lot of people, is they're going to start viewing that as feels like homework. This feels tedious. I just want to sit back and enjoy this thing. And if I think this looks entertaining to me and I go into it and then I'm like, wait a second, I needed to watch like 20 hours across how many other titles and shows and movies, whatever it is, to understand what's happening right now, that's not a good scenario. And I know for people who are sticking with it the whole way, they probably think, oh, well, what's the big deal? But most people, that means you're never going to start getting these new people on board all the time to get into something. They're going to see it and they're going to feel intimidated by that, and then that's going to be it. And that's what happened in the main comic lines, because they kept saying that this continuity, instead of it being our strength and having a history for these characters and that you can go and find out more, it became a crux, because it's one of these things where, oh, every single thing that happens in this issue, you had to have read 50, 60 other issues to fully get the scope and understanding of what's happening here.
They do these big events where it's like tie-ins, and that's what's really...
Yeah.
People have bowed out. I know Shadowhawk said, yeah, I bowed out. I mean, and I did too. It put me off. When you've got a storyline like No Man's Land with Batman in the 90s, which I think is the longest.
Oh, man. Wow. Yeah.
Or Dark Knight or whatever it was. It's just, it's too much. It's expecting too much of the reader. I think the reader becomes, the collector tends to resent it, you know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Time.
Like you're just trying to fleece them for cash. And
well, especially if there's no really big payoff. That's what happened to me after the first, and it's weird even to say the first Civil War event. It's like there should have only been one.
Yeah.
You know, and then even then it should have been half the size of what it was, and it should have had twice the impact of what it did.
And they're,
but yeah, after that, I was out.
Yeah, and their yearly has turned into like an event every 6 months. So they have two a year. It's like, wow, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
It was fun to see
what we're going to be doing at Alterna with this Blood Realm King Cryptid crossover.
Oh, wow.
What's going to be these two issues. Mm-hmm. And it's in continuity, but it's not within the series. So it's not Blood Realm number or King Cryptid number. It's treated as its own separate sort of event that has a lot of bonus extra stuff in it. But also there's things that happen in it that will matter to both titles. But it's not this big, long, drawn-out thing. We're going to be doing the two issues, and then that's it. And it will be nice and fun, and you learn more about both characters.
Are you going to do a campaign with both those issues?
Yeah, we'll be launching one around July. Those, so yeah, we got artwork being done on them right now, but yeah, so that's going to be a lot of fun, and it's not going to be something that is this big daunting sort of thing, and you had to read all the King Cryptids and you had to read all the Blood Realms, and yeah, you know, you're going to be lost. It's going to be made and set up so that if you are new to both titles, you could just jump right in and,
yeah, that's
and get
a win-win
acclimated
for both of you and your properties, your IPs. That's great, man. I wish there was more. There has been some, you know, crossovers with companies and things, and I've got one slated myself for later, which will probably be, gosh, a year from now. So looking down the road, but with Fembat and versus Devil Flyer, but, you know, Apex Comics does Fembat.
Yeah, because it's fun to see the characters meet and do something and have a story around them. But once it becomes dependent upon that, that's when I think it starts rubbing people the wrong way.
You had Batman and Spawn and different events like that. And that's the way I kind of look at the MCU and the movies kind of separate, because they don't really quite go with the comics anyway. You almost have to look at them as an alternate universe or realm, or, you know, these are the movies and these are the books, and that the twain shall never meet, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Shall never meet. Yeah. But man, thank you for it's gonna be a lot of fun. And thank you for coming on tonight. Really appreciate you stopping by. And all the best with your project. What's your project again and where is it?
Devil Flyer over on Fun My Comic. We're in demand now. We'll be in demand for the next few months, but concentrating on mostly the books. We've got an artist edition and got a Jimmy Reyes cover, wraparound cover dropping here pretty soon.
Nice.
And got one by John Dillard and one by my neighbor, John Fernandez, that did the main feature, and something for a little bit of everybody. Kind of, you know, kind of like the Diaz brothers, where it's kind of like anthology where you dip your toe in. You have a little horror, a little hero, a little romance, a little adventure, sci-fi, whatever. You know,
I like. So you're gonna be back here next week for Open Mic Friday.
Sure.
All right. Yeah. I'm bringing that back. We're gonna have 5 minute slots. It's gonna be once a month, the last Friday of each month. I'm gonna have an open mic show. Everybody can come on for 5 minutes, promote their project, and get that going. So I hope
that's
to see you next
week.
That's
more generous than Don Chin. He only gives you 4 minutes, and he's not even doing it anymore. He's doing real
well. I used to just give three, but I feel like that's unfair at this point because I haven't done it in about a year. So yeah. I'm gonna get people back in the swing of it with 5 minutes.
Well, good. I put myself down for my for on the calendar right now, so I don't forget.
All right, fantastic. Thank All right, too. Man. Take it easy. Have a great night. Have a great weekend.
You too, bro.
All right. Let's see. I got someone waiting in the wings here, but before I do that, before I bring him on, I wanted to show you guys something. These arrived the other day. These are the King Cryptid Eclipse die cut stickers. They got like this brushed metallic look to them. And these came in here about maybe 2 days ago. These are for King Cryptid King Size Campaign subscription backers, Super Moon Bundle backers, and also those who backed when we had the eclipse that we had, which fell obviously on a new moon. We had that solar eclipse, so this was a new moon special at that point in time. If you grabbed one, you're gonna get one soon. Also, these arrived today too. We got the new trading cards, the Alterna cards, number 17 and 18. Hector Ramos and the Blighted. Hector is from Trespasser. So if you guys read that Trespasser miniseries, that's Christian Rossi art, story by Justin M. Ryan. Trespasser number one is a Hall of Fame book. Got inducted a few weeks back. There's only, I think, 14 left of that one. The Blighted, of course, is from Blood Realm. Little sneak peek at that. And Blood Realm number one, a Hall of Fame book as well. Only three left of that one. Only three. Holy smokes. We're only making 50 to sell. And that's it. Once they're gone, they're gone. So if you missed out on that, please, before you miss out forever, if you were interested, go pick it up. We got those on alternacomics.com/pre-order. And also, I'm going to be working on these. These are all blank. I don't have any art to show you right now. But for the art auctions this weekend, I'm going to be working on this 5x7. What'll I draw in there? I don't really know just yet. And then I got some old school Alterna originals. These were from years ago. What year? 2012. This is from the very first time we did trading cards. We had a 5-card set and a bunch of sketch cards. And these are the blanks. So I'm going to make 4 on these. And then I figured I did sketch cards for Leaf, the company Leaf, a long time ago. Here's an artist proof. I still have like 5 or 6 of them. I figured, you know, why not? I'll draw something on that. I'll draw an Alterna card on this Leaf artist proof. And I'll have that on the auction this weekend too. But what'll I make on them? I don't know. We'll see. I know one of them I want to draw Behemoth. I wanted to draw that last month. I didn't get a chance to. So we'll see what I have. All right, let's see here. Hey, Bob says, Pete getting Dina Martin will get my respect. He's a great guy. Well, thank you, Bob. It was a pleasure talking to Dina. And I hope I can get her back on the show again. You know, maybe months down the line. You don't want to bother anybody, you know. But it was great getting to talk to her. And I have a few more questions and some more conversation I'd like to have with her, so hopefully we're able to do that. But it was amazing having her on, and just one of the coolest things of my life. So thank you, Bob, for sharing that with me too. Appreciate it. All right, let's see who we have here backstage. This will be the last guest of the night, I guess you could say. It'll be Dirk. What's up?
Hey, how's it going, Pete?
It's going good. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great. Just thought I'd stop in and say hey. Saw the open lines. I thought, hey, it'd be great to talk to you.
All right. Yeah. Thank you for stopping by. What's on your mind tonight?
Not a lot. I mean, I'm kind of in a weird spot right now. Murph and Dirk, we didn't call it quits, but we've laid it off for a little while.
Okay. So, yeah. I knew you were thinking about something like that. Mm-hmm. Can you explain what's going on?
Yeah, I think we've just decided to back the show down a little bit and worry more about the comic itself, you know, focus on what's more important than, you know, just trying to keep our presence up there. We have other ways to keep our presence alive, I think. And so I think the show's just going to kind of just morph into something else. That's more what it will be. I think we're going to do some draw streams. We'll do events, like if we just want to, you know, grab a bunch of people and have more of a fun time and not worry about, I have to be every Tuesday at 8 o'clock. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Well, it's good to mix it up, you know?
Yeah.
And you mix it up and you end up finding something that maybe works out even better.
I think so too. It may be a place for us to grow is what I'm hoping.
Absolutely. So. Oh, good.
Yeah.
What other kind of social media are you utilizing to get the word out there on your stuff?
Well, trying to do a little more Instagram. I'm not good at that. I'm way behind on that one, man. I actually need to interact more on Twitter, too. I do a lot of retweeting, but I don't get in there and have conversations with people, and I think I need to do that a little more.
Oh, okay.
And then... I don't know. It's weird. Our book is now on Amazon, so you can get our book digitally right now. And in a minute, I mean, it's under review, but the physical copy is going to be on there as well. So we're going to have a little more place, you know, a little more, a few more places to get the book than what we could before, which is awesome. So cool. Pretty happy about that. So, we're still growing. We're changing. It's just, trying to figure this whole thing out, man, is just
are you feeling stagnant with how it's been going? Like, what's the the biggest motivating factor for the change up?
Yeah, I would say stagnation. I would say noticing that I'm not really getting my drawing done. And, you know, I've been looking at the same 3-4 pages of the book for months, and I'm going, what's happening here? That's not good. You know, I want to start putting out and producing. And, you know, we're doing 30 pages to a book, and I'm going, oh my gosh, I need to have these done. You know, we've been going on a year and a half since launch of our first book, or since fulfillment of our first book, and time is getting away from us. You know what I mean?
Is Tuesday night like one of the only nights you have free time?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, yeah. You know, in that scenario, yeah, I definitely understand wanting to utilize that more towards getting the book done.
Yeah, I think even like right now, I'm sitting here drawing and I'm listening to a chat and I'm going, this is great. You know, I love this. This is more fun for me. And I'm actually feeling like I can get back in touch with what I'm doing instead of worrying about a schedule, you know?
Yeah.
And I need that. I need to get back into just being an artist again and letting that be my focus, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, everyone's got to figure out what works for them.
Yeah.
You know, everyone's schedule is different. That's why I dread questions where people are like, Pete, how can I run my company, or how can I, make my comic? And I'm like, man, I don't know what it's like to be you. And I don't have necessarily that time to learn your entire life, because that's what it encompasses. You know, I got to learn your entire life and what has led you to this moment.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, I have to know that you 100% will not hold anything against me for any of the advice I give you.
Right.
So it's too much of a crushing responsibility to give to me on that. So it's more like, give me a specific question. Are you having trouble with figuring out your file? Are you having trouble with, you know, working on lettering? Are you, you know, mm-hmm. But when it's this huge question of like,
But, you know, that's the gold. Yeah. I mean, that's what people want to know. All of us, you know, up and comers, we're like, how do you do it? What are you doing? And it's like, well, yeah, you got to figure it out. It's nothing anybody can teach you about that. You know, you have to balance, and then you have to do what works for you. So.
Yeah. In a lot of ways, it really is like you're jumping off the mountain and you got to build your parachute on the way down. You know?
Yeah. Well, it's weird because all the advice we were getting was, oh, you shouldn't do that. You got to stay on there because you need a YouTube channel. And I'm going, I don't know if you do need a YouTube channel. I see several artists that are doing pretty well without YouTube channels, you know?
That's the thing is like some of this will help you. Some of it will hurt you if you're not finding a way to benefit from it or get anything positive out of it, even if you don't get something necessarily monetarily out of it, but you really enjoy doing it, that's a positive. But if everything turns into, you know, well, it's taking away my time from the other priorities that I have, and, you know, I'm frustrated with whatever it might be, the algorithm, the subscriber base of not being able to grow, or maybe struggling to come up with new shows or new topics to talk about or anything. It's a million things.
I feel like we were actually starting to hit a pretty good stride there for a little while with topics and things, but we still weren't seeing the growth. And I just started saying to myself, well, I'm not getting the return on investment, and I actually feel drawn away from, you know, what I'm loving. So I would rather put my time and effort into something that I love to do and then refocus. And, you know, like I said, now that we're on Amazon, I can push our book digitally on a new platform. Yeah. And we didn't have that before. And that was a pretty cool thing. And now we're trying to navigate, okay, business-wise, what do we do with a product that's readily available with, you know, for people? How are we going to market it? You know, what are we going to do to get people to, you know, notice it and, you know, and then buy it? The big one, buy it.
Well, what's the plan in terms of getting the word out there? Is that how you were using YouTube before, was to primarily get the word out there?
That was the big one. I mean, you know, you hear from some of these bigger creators are like, yeah, you got to have it because you get, you know, people will see your book and all this, and it's to build your audience. And I'm going, okay, yeah, I think you do get a few people, but to be honest, a lot of the people that were in there were other creators, you know? And so I think, which they backed our book too. It's just that it wasn't giving us an audience of readers as much as we wanted it to. You know, there were some, but I think the plan to get the word out now is, I think, is to keep putting ourselves in other venues that are, they could even be smaller right now, but it's going to gain us some traction. Does that make sense? So yeah. I've been asked recently to be in a showcase in my local art league in my local town, and you know, they're going to showcase some comic art. That's actually really cool. And they never do that. Yeah. And I'm like, well, that venue is a place that I can get people to give me their signups. You know, I can ask for email addresses, start getting some, you know, some things that I feel like is much needed for creators to be able to do. They got to start making those connections with people. Comic-Con does.
To me, the number one thing, the most valuable thing you're going to have as a creator, as a business in this day and age, is a newsletter. Yeah. And I know some people look at that and they go, a newsletter, you know, that seems kind of like this old thing. But there is nothing more effective than that. Yeah. Because you could be on social media, you could do whatever and everything. The newsletter is the digital equivalent of a direct mail campaign. And when done right, it's the most effective thing you could do. YouTube, this side of it is like being on like public access TV, that sort of thing, you know? Right. And it's good and it's valuable depending on if you can do it. So either you're really good at it or you're so bad at it that you're an entertaining train wreck, you know? So if you're in the middle, it could be a real struggle.
I think we were a train wreck sometimes, but I think it was fun.
I guess not enough, maybe.
Come on, right? Man. Yeah, not enough to be entertaining, I guess. But yeah, no, we really had a great time with our show. And I'm going to tell you, I'm bummed because I didn't want to let it go too much. But then I thought, I really got to think about this and be honest with myself. And that was the big deal. And I am going to miss. I think we had a great chat. I think we had great things about our show. And I'm not trying to belittle that at all. I think we had some really good things. But I'm excited to kind of go do new things. And, you know, now that I'm going to be in a showcase for about 2 months as a, you know, as an artist locally, I find that as an opportunity to start connecting with local people. And then I'm also looking to do, I'd like to go to some toy shows, some cons, things like that, you know, places where think I can meet some people.
Now for you, would you say that your goals have changed?
Slightly. Not in a big way, but just, I'm trying to think more globally, I guess you could say. Not just looking right in front of me, but actually looking out and seeing the bigger picture. That's kind of hard to do. I mean, it really is. You know, part of that is understanding, because I was asking for a long time, how are you guys growing your email lists and how are you doing this? And nobody would give us any answers. And then I finally caught on to some things and I was like, okay, now it makes more sense. And it's not just going to cons, but, you know, there's some other ways to do it. And people are leveraging like their digital books and things like that. And I want to try.
Yeah, you could do that. You know, you offer a preview. There was one point in time where we were offering all of our number ones in digital for free. And this was back when, I don't know, maybe 2018, something like that.
Yeah.
And so people got something like, I don't know, 15 comics or something to sign up for the newsletter. And now now we give a 10% coupon when anyone signs up for the Alterna Comics newsletter.
Ooh, that's awesome.
But over the years, you know, on that level too, you're probably always going to find that maybe roughly 10 or so percent of the people who open the newsletter, it converts to a sale or anything like that.
Sure.
But just being able to keep people updated
is
great. You know, I think we have something like, I think, a 70 or 75% open rate on our newsletter, which is pretty high.
So I ask, what's in the newsletter? It's updates about the books, or do you do subject
It's matter? Usually updates about the books, or like, here's a sale that's going on, or here's a new campaign that's coming up or has launched. You know, here are these little things, depending, like the Hall of Fame books, where those are limited to 50. I'll provide like an update maybe once a week on that. I only really send out a newsletter maybe once or twice a week at the most. But usually once a week. And it'll have something that's pertinent to what's going on with Alterna, a book, a series, a campaign, you know, a production, whatever's happening. We kind of just get in and out. So it's not like a big, some people make a big blog post out of it and have it more like it's a big letter to whoever's on the newsletter. Right. There's all kinds of ways to do it.
Yeah.
But the important part is being able to update people. Like the way most people should be updating their crowdfunding campaigns. The newsletter is essentially that, only there doesn't have to be a crowdfunding campaign to necessarily send one out. It's just, you have to have something to say, something to talk about and let people know about. But yeah, there's a million ways to do it. And some of the people that are out there that have newsletters are utilizing them really effectively even, and make like a nice, almost like a tutorial out of it, or they'll detail something about, you know, they'll tackle a topic and talk about that for a few paragraphs or something. There's all kinds of ways to do it.
Yeah, that I was real curious because we were thinking, you know, well, we need to grow the email list. And it's like, okay, what do we email? And we were like, okay, well, making a newsletter. And I'm going, okay, but I can only say I'm working on pages so many times, you know, so we need to have something that's interesting and maybe something that gives them a little bit of a hook or something. Even if it's a tidbit of information or even a story, I thought that'd be good, a good idea. So yeah, that's on the route. we're trying to take.
Nice. So, yeah.
We'll see how it plans out or how it pans out, you know. You never know.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, it's good to see, you know, you're, and everyone should always be doing this. I'm always doing this with, you know, evaluating whether something is working or not. And
yeah.
And if you want to keep doing it, but you feel like it's grown stale or you're not happy with the outcome of it or whatever, well, then you got to start quantifying what are you doing exactly. Like yeah. when you were originally talking about it, I was like, okay, well, what are you doing? What kind of goal do you have in mind? Are you having like 1,000 subs? Are you having like every video gets 200 views? Every video gets 1,000 views?
Sure.
Like what's your goals? And then what are you doing to reach them? Because a lot of the time, yeah. and I'm not saying you were doing this, but a lot of the times people sit there and then they go, oh crap, I never actually thought about any of that. You know, so there's things, and I've seen a lot just even as a publisher where people will go, I want to get published. You know, that's a goal. And so then they get published. And they never thought about it past that.
Right.
So then when there's no sales really that come in for them, they get disappointed because they thought everything after that point would just take care of itself.
Yeah.
And then
yeah,
it would be self-sustaining and it would be great. And all you had to do was get published.
Right.
You know, or all you had to do was get in the store, or all you had to do was get distribution, or all you had to do was get one person to read it, you know,
right.
or get it reviewed by so and so, or get a press release acknowledged by whoever. And it's like, you can't, there's not, I don't think there's one thing ever that you could do that say, I did that thing the one time, and then everything else took care of itself after that.
Right. It's right. I mean, to be honest, we did have short-sighted goals when we started, and we were like, no, we've got to make a book. So we made a book, and then we're like, okay, how do we sell? And it was exactly what you were saying. It was very short-sighted. But I think now it's like, okay, you know, reality sets in and you start looking at it and you're going, okay, where are we going? Where do we want to go? Of course we want to get more sales, but we also, I want to draw people in that are going to stick around. I don't want to just get surface people. You know what I mean? That's fine. You have to a little bit to get some numbers out of it. But for the most part, when I get these and I collect some email addresses, I'm hoping to actually make some connections so that they stick around. I want them to get some substance, you know? So they... You know what I mean? Because they're the ones who are really going to buy your stuff. They're going to stick around for you. They're going to like what's going on. And, you know, some of the guys who just go, oh, that's a nice looking comic. Yeah, I'll give you my email address. And they just toss it in there. It's like, I don't know. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's like the people at the convention that they're going to look at everyone else and then they'll get back to you.
Yeah, you know, exactly.
And like one out of 50 of those people actually does come back.
Right. Now, I'm thankful to get their email address and everything, but it's like, man, you know, I really want the people who want to engage. And
yeah, then you look and you're like, don't email me at gmail.com.
Exactly.
It's like giving the fake phone number kind of a thing.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
555. Right. That's awesome. Yeah, man.
Yeah, there's all kinds of ways to go about doing all this. Whenever, I don't trust anyone who ever is like, there's the one way to do it, and if you don't do it that way, you're going to fail. You know,
right.
I want to be like, dude, no. That's not true of anything ever, you know?
I've seen so many different ways in this community, and that's the hard part. It's like, okay, what's best for us? And we don't know. And we tried listening to some of the bigger creators and they're like, yeah, you got to have a YouTube. We tried it and it's like, I mean, it went good for a while and we never made it to 1,000 subs and we didn't even make it to 500, you know? And I'm going, okay, we have good content. We have good people on here. I feel like our chat's great. What's happening? I never figure that out, you know?
So, I mean, this is a good question to, we'll go till an hour and a half. So six more minutes now.
I don't mean to keep you. If you got to go, man, I didn't mean to run you over.
No, it's okay. But with the YouTube conversation, I 100% obviously believe that it can be helpful. Now it's helpful for me. That's what I mean by it. It's been helpful for me and I've had to find ways to make it helpful for me. But when people are sometimes, getting discouraged by it, like kind of the way that you're in right now. Now, if you were in a different mindset where it had the time even to do so, I do all this stuff full time. This is what I do. I make comics. I do whatever I do. This is it. I don't have any other kind of job. This is what I'm doing. Yeah. Back when I did 2 to 3 jobs at a time and also made comics, no, it wouldn't have been. I didn't even do YouTube at that point in time. I maybe uploaded a video every now and then and walked away. So to do this, if you wanted to be involved in this level, if you're doing something at a certain time slot, think about the time slot, think about the subject matter, think about, and I'm not saying for you necessarily, but someone who, like, they want to make YouTube a priority, you know? So if YouTube is a priority to you, then think about it in that way. And you have to have all these different, you know, you got to try out what you want to do. But if the priority is making the comic, which for you, that's what it sounds like it is. And for every comic creator, that really should be what it is. You should be a comic creator first, and then everything else is in benefit to that, or if anything, funneling to that.
Yeah, right.
Well, then you got to think, how does that fit in what I can do? If you find that everything else is eating up the majority of your time compared to getting the comic done or out there, then you got to reassess how that's going for you. If you find that it's more beneficial for you and you enjoy it more to do everything but make the comic, then maybe you got to reassess that too. And you got to think, crap, maybe I really don't do this as much because I've fallen in love with doing this now.
Right.
You know? Right. So it's a difficult thing, I think, and only the individual can really answer that for themselves. So for you to see what you're doing and, you know, go along that path, I think it's good.
Thanks, man. No, you really, you helped me a lot. You responded to my, one of my Twitter posts, and I really appreciated what you said there. And it, you know, it made me think a lot about it because I was like, you know, you're right. I want to assess what's going on and not just rush into this, but I also have to look at the big picture and, you know, as the artist, because it's just me and Murph doing the book for now, you know, he writes and then he's sitting there, you know, waiting on me and I'm not able to get to everything that I need to get to do, you know, to get done for the pages. And I'm going, man, he's waiting forever on me. And I could have had this done by now and I should have had it done by now. So I'm thinking, yeah, we're just delaying. And I want the book out. You know, I've improved my art. I've watched myself grow, and I'm sitting there thinking to myself, but I don't have time to put into it. Like, I'll go a couple weeks in between drawing, and that's not good. Once you feel like you've improved your art, you're going to lose some of the skill that you've improved on because you can't keep practicing it. And so I was like, yeah, this is taken away. It's not benefiting. It's a hard one to face.
I mean,
you know, it's necessary.
I know the world has changed, but the greatest comic creators of all time didn't need YouTube to succeed, right? I know the world has changed, though, but it's been first and foremost about the content, about what they were making, about the story, about the characters, about the art.
Yep.
You know, so if that takes a backseat to the marketing, I mean, now you're basically, in a way, you're kind of selling out, because selling out is all about taking money at the loss of quality. If you take money and you can keep the quality up or surpass your previous quality, that's not really selling out. That's just the natural order of things. But if you're like, oh no, I'll take that money and I'll give you crap, you know, that's not gonna last, you know. So it has to become part of a healthy, balanced diet in terms of what you're doing with your business. And if it's taking it over, that has to be something that you have to recognize. But I think sometimes maybe that happens too late and people don't recognize that until, oh wow, like, this is, you know, I'm crazy late, or the quality diminished, or, you know, I'm losing customers now. I'm noticing that I'm not getting anything close to the amount of people on this one that backed me on the previous one.
Right.
You know, whatever that may be. But you have to look at it and adjust to whether or not you're okay with that. And that's, again, only individuals can answer that for themselves.
Right.
But, you know, and then conversely, if you're a customer or a supporter of anyone, you can only answer that for yourself. Well, do I continue to support or do I not continue to support? Is this okay with me or is this not okay with me?
Right.
I'm not about telling people that that shouldn't be okay with you. I'm not about telling people that, you know, you should expect this out of someone else, or that if you're doing this, you should do this way. Do whatever makes you happy. Do whatever brings you joy, you know, and figure out what that is and stick with it. Certain things bring certain people joy and certain things don't bring certain people joy. And if that works for you, hey, keep it up. But, you know, so what you're doing, if you're looking at that and going, okay, I feel like my priorities are out of whack, like that's great. It's great to have that moment of self-reflection and then go, okay, I got to get back on course again.
Right. Right.
I mean, no one's getting up in your face about it, right? They're not like telling you.
Nobody.
Okay, good.
This was on my own. I mean, I'm starting to look at things. I'm looking at the whole picture and I'm going, man, you know, all these other channels, I've seen guys come in way behind us, you know, way after us. I mean, starting a channel and next thing I know, they're at 1,000 subs and I'm going, wow, you know, what are we not doing or what are we doing wrong? And then I'm thinking to myself, well, I can't put more into this than what I am. And so is it worth it? Is it paying off? Is it worth the return on investment, you know, investment for me? And I just don't think it is. I think it's something.
And you mean return on investment meaning time, the time that you're putting in.
Time, growth, you know, you're looking at the whole thing. You're not just looking at one aspect of it. You're looking at all of it. I think what it did do was keep us having relationships with people. You know, we were able to, like with you and with other creators, we had a lot of creators come on our show, you know, and had a great time. And that's one of the best things that I really enjoyed about the show. And then our chat was awesome too. So we had good support there. It's just, it wasn't growing, you know, it wasn't doing anything. And I thought, well, I feel like the point of these channels is to grow and to maintain an audience and to grow that audience. You know, I mean, it's for the book. So it wasn't for anything else. I don't want to be a YouTube star. You know, that's not my intention at all.
Yeah, it looks like you wanted to have some conversations with those that were out there that like the comics and then let them know, you know, what you guys are about and what you're creating, what you're working on, what your approach to things is.
Yep.
And, you know, I think that's great. And I don't think you have to feel that you are beholden to some kind of schedule that you set. I mean, that's the thing, too. Even with me, I eventually hit a point with Alterna where I'm like, most of these things, these are rules and conditions that I made. It's like I'm sticking to these arbitrary things I created.
Right.
That some of them, it's great, and some of them were not so great, and they weren't bringing me joy, and it wasn't good, and it was kind of blocking a lot of other avenues, you know. Yes. So figuring that out and going, well, the only reason I'm not doing this or I'm not doing that or whatever is because I decided arbitrarily that that's just what I think that shouldn't be done, you know. And eventually you hit a point where you realize, like, wow, I'm the only one holding me back from being happy about stuff.
Yes. Yeah, it's weird how you put your own expectations. You know, you put harsh expectations on yourself, and then it does limit you. It really does.
Yeah.
Instead of, or it can.
Yeah, exactly. Instead of kind of giving yourself a set of parameters to succeed and be happy.
Yeah.
Oftentimes we give ourselves these parameters that we think we need to do to succeed.
Right.
And it often means like every single thing is like sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice.
Right.
And yes, you're going to be sacrificing obviously various things to achieve what you want. But if you just constantly are putting yourself in the state of misery and diminishment, man, you're not going to want to keep doing that much longer.
It's true. Yeah. I was getting burnt out to where I mean, it took away from drawing too, because then I wasn't feeling like it. I was like, I just don't want to have anything to do with it right now. And so I was like, this isn't good. You know, I want to just I'd love to be able to just practice and draw and have fun, and then also work on pages so that I could keep my skill up. Because, you know, I'm a musician too, and I very much know about how once you get your skills at a certain level, you have to work to keep them there. You don't just get there and all of a sudden they're there forever. That's not the way it works.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to work at it and you have to keep it. And it's, you know, I want to stay sharp on my craft. And I felt like I was hitting a new plateau, and then I was being pulled away, and I was just like, ah, that's the most frustrating ever. And so, yeah, it's about, I want to enjoy my craft, and I want to enjoy people, and I want to make some fun, you know, I want to have some good times. And so I think not having that weighing on us anymore, we're going to be able to have more fun with it. We'll do it less often, but we'll have more fun. And who knows, we might do other things like draw streams and things like that, where we don't feel so beholden to a certain type of show. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, what geeks you, that's what I was thinking too. It's not like riding a bike. And thank you for the kind words, man. But, you know, so what you're talking about too, it reminds me of that. That is how you actually achieve anything that puts you on the right path in life. Like, you know, when you're like, let's say it's about a relationship, you're trying to find a relationship, you're dating, you're doing whatever, you're trying to find someone. Yep. You know, when you have like the stink of desperation on you, when you are constantly putting yourself in a position of you're uncomfortable, you're being awkward, you're not free, you're not feeling like you're being who you are, you're being who you think someone wants you to be. When you are constantly doing that, you don't find anybody. The moment you start living your life and going, you know, what matters to me? What makes me happy? Who am I? What do I want to do? The moment you start doing that and going down that path in life, that is when you find the things that you want out of life.
Yeah.
So I think that seriously, it's going to be this way for you guys. You're going to all of a sudden be like, wow, like all of a sudden we're just making this a part of what we do and not like a big focus of what we do. Because the focus is on what really matters to us. And all of a sudden, everything's going to fall into place. Yeah. I guarantee it. That's how it happens every time with everything.
Well, I certainly hope so. That's what I want to happen.
Oh, it's going to. It's going to.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. And, you know, like even right now, I've been drawing and just watching you guys, you know, well, you and Rex talk, and it was great. And, you know, that's part of the fun. I want to feel like I'm enjoying my craft again, you know.
Yeah, law of attraction. It's absolutely real.
Yeah, right.
It's because everything's on a frequency. Everything is energy. So whatever energy you're throwing out there, that's what you're attracting to you, you know. So it works like that with everything.
Yeah.
But that I think that you figured that out. And if anything, like, that's a great place to be in. And I'm really excited to see where you guys go, because I think you're going to start really growing in a really positive direction with the comic stuff that you want to focus on. I think then when you come back and you do the YouTube stuff or whatever you want to do, and you have your shows or a guest or a topic or whatever it is, I think you're going to have even more fun with it. And that's going to attract even more people to pay attention to what it is that you're doing. You know, so instead of being like the weekly whatever it turns into, you become this must see event every time Dirk and Murph roll around, you know.
Yeah, that's what I was hoping. Yeah, I want it to be a good time. I want to make it, you know, worth everybody's while, and then it'll be something, you know.
Yeah.
It's not just, oh, okay, here we go again, you know.
Absolutely.
You know, somebody totally said in the chat earlier, they were like, yeah, there's only so many hours in the day and so many streams out there. And I'm like, yeah, it's just inundated. So
totally,
but it's kind of crazy to keep up with.
Dirk, I'm gonna let you get back to work, and I gotta get back to work too. I gotta ship stuff tomorrow. So
all right, man. It was right, great, man. Talking to you again.
Good talking to you as well, and I can't wait to see where you guys end up in a year or two from now on this newfound path. I think it's gonna be good, man.
Thanks. All right
brother.
The chat, see you.
Take
guys.
It easy. All right. And SDA, thank you so much for all of the links you're popping in there tonight. I appreciate it. Talking about Blood Realm, Dawn of the Wolf, only a couple days left on that campaign. Rob is, getting closer and closer to his stretch goal at 12K. And he's already reached his funding goal. He reached that yesterday. He's had two huge days so far. So if you guys are getting in there or you've already gotten on there to support him, thank you guys. Get four new comics for $9. The Alterna campaign, we're getting books out to the printer very soon, so we're gonna get those things fulfilled. Let's see, King Cryptid 5-9. It's, yeah, you're just all up in this tonight. Man, oh man, thank you so much for putting those links out there. Really appreciate it. And then King Cryptid number 1-4, yes, available now at alternacomics.com/King Cryptid. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. And again, like I had said before, a Holo Fame campaign books. These are up until April 30th. These have holochrome covers, premium silk-coated interiors, no ads on the inside, and limited to 50. These four books have achieved notable things during their time at Alterna. Blood Realm number 1, Red Coin number 1, Tinseltown number 1, and Trespasser number 1. There's only 3 left out of the 50 of Blood Realm. There's 10 left out of the 50 of Red Coin. There's 12 left out of the 50 of Tinseltown, and there's 14 left out of the 50 of Trespasser. So if you want to check those out, go to alternacomics.com/preorder and pick yours up before they are sold out or before April 30th. I don't know if these are going to last until April 30th. So if you did want these, I hope you get them soon if you haven't got them already. All right, guys, that's it. Tomorrow night, or the rest of the weekend, I should say, too, we're going to be having an Alterna Comics art, books, and collectibles auction. It's going to be me and Rob Geronimo tomorrow. I was hoping we could have got Keir Covington and Tyler for tomorrow. We're going to have Tyler on Sunday. And Keir has been so busy with books because he's working on the Blood Realm King Cryptid crossover, which is called Blood Moon. And he's been also working on... He just finished up King Cryptid number 9, and he's going to be working on finishing up the rest of Blood Realm, I believe 17 or 18. I know he's on 18, but he's also on 17 too. So he's a busy guy. He doesn't have anything for the auction, so he said, I'm not going to join. So it's going to be me and Rob tomorrow. I got a bunch of stuff. Rob's got a bunch of stuff. And then Sunday will be Tyler, Rob, and myself on the Alterna channel. Those are starting at 8:30 Eastern tomorrow and on Sunday. I hope to see you guys there. Otherwise, I'll be back here for a draw stream during the day on Sunday. I'm going to be drawing one or two of those things that I had showed the blanks for, and then I'll be auctioning them off later on Sunday night. Other than that, and thank you, Adam Warlock. Yeah, it's fitting. It's fitting. So we'll have Blood Moon Part 1 of 2 and Blood Moon Part 2 of 2. Same campaign. And then we'll also have them, well, they'll be in single issues on that campaign, but they'll also be offered on the campaign too as a very limited edition trade put all together as a graphic novel. And Rob will be doing this collage cover for the graphic novel. Keir will be doing this amazing, it's hard to even describe, it's so cool, wrap around connected cover for the single issues. So if you wanted, you could even take them out and put up a poster and all that fun stuff, you know, old school style. But anyway, I'll see you guys hopefully this weekend at some point in time. If I don't, everyone have a wonderful weekend and a great Monday. But until then, until that Monday comes, everyone have a great night and an even better tomorrow. I'll see you guys soon. All the best to you.